graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
It was the Week 10 matchup of the Reef Stompers and the Roughland Richbacks. The match was tied at one game apiece, and the deciding round was capture the flag. There were still 2 weeks till the end of the season, and two spots remained for the championship tournament. The fur-covered nightmare beast came straight at Pete. Four massive legs supporting a 7-ton body, mostly covered in battered blue composite armor, decorated with scratched and gouged advertising logos. Its rider, a tiny quith leader, dressed in matching blue armor and carrying a long lance, was screaming at the creature. His voice lost in the roar of the crowd. The beast's hooked armor-covered pedipalps were almost as big as the legs. Those pedipalps reached forward, twitched, ready to grab prey and drag it to the vertical maw of jagged black teeth. Beneath his black and crimson helmet, the Poughkeepsie Pete smiled. Most people said nightmare beasts looked kind of like spiders or crabs. To Pete, the thing looked like a giant tick, and ticks were born to be squished. This was the moment the stadium crowd had waited for, a heavyweight squaring off against another in a battle that might leave one of them dead. But if so, it wouldn't be Pete's mount left broken and bleeding on Smittick's Arena's packed dirt.
Kill one of mine, will you? Let's see how you bleed.
Bess, rush!
Pete's thighs pressed in against the leather saddle. He felt the power generated by the 6,500 kilos of muscle and bone beneath him. Old Bess quickened her pace. Bess, the only T-Rex in the sport of dinolition, leaned into her sprint and roared. Pete's fingers tightened on the warhammer in his left hand. The nightmare beast closed in for a head-on collision, a single eye looking out through the thick bars of a protective visor. Pete unhooked his armored left boot from the saddle's stirrup. Scant meters before the crushing impact, Bess effortlessly shifted right so the two monsters would pass side by side. The little quith leader reacted well, swinging his lance to drive the point into Pete's red armored chest. Pete swung his left foot back over Bess's body, coming out of the saddle, letting the right stirrup carry all of his weight. The lance tip hissed through empty air where Pete had just been. Right hand on the saddle horn, Pete wrist-whipped his war hammer in a short circle, bringing it down on his opponent's lance, snapping the long weapon in two a good meter from the tip. Pete's strike against the lance was more distraction than disarmament, keeping the leader from recognizing Bess's simultaneous move. The T-Rex drove her wide armored head down hard against the nightmare beast's rear left leg. Plates of blue armor bent and spun free to expose the black and green carapace beneath. Black liquid sprayed out in a cloud as the leg snapped. Screeching with pain, the nightmare beast turned sharply, spinning in place like a disc anchored by three still functioning legs. The creature thrust its blocky head forward and snapped at Bess's neck with jaws that opened side to side rather than up and down. Most of the jagged black teeth scratched harmlessly against Bess's sparkling red armor, doing little more than scraping a gouge in the logos for Junkie Gin and Maddox Hover Repair. But two teeth drove through a seam in that armor and dug into the soft flesh beneath. Crimson blood flew. Bess reared back, the 6-ton T-Rex roaring in pain. Pete timed the moment of her lurch, right hand on the saddle horn and right boot locked in the stirrup. The 1-meter-tall armor-clad man waited till Bess regained control before he kicked his left leg back over the saddle and clicked it home.
Bess, fight!
Bess lunged down with all the power in her massive frame, but this time, instead of using her head as a battering ram, she opened wide her jagged maw and clamped her jaws tight on the beast's already damaged leg. At the same time, Pete, his boots locked in the armored stirrups, stood tall on the saddle and put all his weight into a swing at the nightmare beast's head. The spidery thing shivered at the shock of two simultaneous wounds, 20-centimeter teeth crunching through the beast's armor, exoskeleton, and into the flesh beyond, and Pete's warhammer smashing against the creature's left pedipalp. The alien monster screeched in a high-pitched wail and bucked backwards. Jaws dripping with blood, Bess opened wide and bit again, this time into the beast's flank. Her teeth, armor-piercing daggers that punched through blue plate. Blood sprayed from the wound, sheeting the forward punch drive's logo painted on Bess's red helmet, even splashing across Pete's visor, helmet, and chest. The beast stumbled backwards on unsteady legs, trying to escape the T-Rex's savage attack. Pete saw that the quick leader rider had slid to the side and was fighting to stay in his saddle. Middle and pedipalp arms, grabbing at stirrups, pommel, the saddle itself, the beast's armor, anything to keep balance. Pete waved the warhammer in a circle above his head, playing to the deafening crowd.
Best butt!
The big, beautiful T-Rex swung her armored head, smashing it into the nightmare beast's rider. The leader sailed from his saddle. His armor instantly contracted, compacting the rider into a tight, protective, armored ball that crashed into the rock-hard dirt, a bit of blue sculpture thrown to the ground like a discarded mag can. Pete looked at the stomper's end of the pitch some 20 meters away. No enemy riders between him and the stomper's dugout, between him and the blue steel-gray flag that hung above it, swaying slightly in the afternoon breeze. The rest of the stomper's riders must be attacking the Ridgeback's flag.
Bess! Sprint!
Pete leaned forward in the saddle. At the exact moment, Bess lurched toward the enemy flag. One powerful thrust, then another, speed building. Smooth strides clearing 3 meters, then four, then almost five as she hit top speed. They closed in on the stomper's flag, anxiety building in Pete as he was so close to victory and might have it snatched away at the last second. Bess slowed, the jarring deceleration punishing Pete as it always did. Bess skidded the last 5 meters and Pete stood in the saddle. He heard the crowd roaring. Bess raised higher. Pete grabbed the stomper's flagpole and yanked it free of the stadium wall. He whipped the flag left and right, the fabric rat-tat-tatting against the air.
Rockland Ridgebacks win round three. The Ridgebacks win the match 2-1.
Bess craned her armored blood-splattered head to the left and peered back at Pete with one large green eye. He saw the long gouge in her helmet that crossed over the open eye hole. Had that strike dug any deeper, his beloved mount might have lost that eye forever. Pete nodded to her. He smiled wide, reached an armored glove out to lightly pat her armored nose.
Good girl, Bessie. Now give these rubes something to write home about.
The T-Rex stood fully upright and lifted her head to the sky. Her victory roar rattled Pete's teeth. Before the sound died away, the 30,000 sentient crowd's own call joined hers, filled the stadium with the rabid glee of the bloodthirsty bunch who had paid good money for this spectacle. It was a decent crowd, but not a sellout. A little over 3/4 full. Not good enough. Pete nudged Bess's side. The T-Rex's head dipped into a theatrical bow, relatively small arms tucked up tight against her massive chest. Pete unhooked his boots from the stirrups, then hopped up to stand on the saddle. Bess did a slow, shuffling circle. The crowd roared louder. Pete had to concede that team owner Sultan the Grimy was right. Sentients just didn't want a fight. They wanted pageantry. Still, this was Pete's job. And if the crowd wanted to see him primp and posture like an egomaniacal actor desperate for recognition, then that's what they would get. When Bess finished the clumsy circle, Pete sat back in the saddle. Bess leaned to her normal, most horizontal posture. Head out front, heavy tail parallel to the ground, and stomped toward the gated dugout at the far end of the oval arena floor. They passed by two limping blue armored spider bears going the other way, ridden by equally beat up and bedraggled armored quick leaders, who had failed to take the Ridgeback's flag, even as the nightmare beast had tried to defend their own. A flag hung from the top of the dugout, red, marked with the black logo of the Roughland Ridgebacks, a shield with a dino-toothed bite out of it. Pete and Bess's teammates, riders and mounts both, waited. Critter Clark, Pete's good friend and the eldest rider on the team, stood next to his mount, Missy. The Gallimimus's red and black logo-covered armor was dented on her flank, exposing the dark yellow feathers beneath. A trickle of blood oozed from beneath the place that covered the left thigh of her long, powerful, ostrich-like legs, although Missy seemed to be in no discomfort. A jagged crack lined Clark's torso armor from the left collarbone to his sternum, splitting the Hill Digger Ground Truck's logo there. But he seemed unharmed. Clark was a little taller than Pete, which meant Clark didn't quite reach the top of Missy's 120-centimeter high hip. The team's only Beishenlong Grandis, Dusty, lay on the dirt floor next to Tony Kester, her white-haired, white-skinned rider. Dusty's neck armor was a splintered mess. When healthy, Dusty's powerful legs could accelerate the 542-kilo dino into a shocking 80 kilometers an hour, turning her into a red-armored, black-skinned blur that caused no end of matchup trouble for opposing teams. The trouble was, Dusty wasn't good at reacting to attacks. She rarely came out of a match without a wound and spent half the season on injured reserve. Tony knelt beside her, his gloves and helmet off, petting her scratched and wounded head. Then there was Ian. When Pete saw Ian standing with his back against the wall, he wanted to charge the kid. The Ridgebacks should have skunked the Reef Stompers 3-0, but Ian's showboating had cost Roughland both a mount and a game. Ian's mount, Tumult, the Ridgeback's best speedster, had been trucked off the pitch because a ground truck with a crane was the only way to move a dead mount. Pete pulled Bess up to the dugout area and flipped off her back. He somersaulted and landed in a crouch. The crowd bellowed once more. Usually the wrap-up was a civilized affair, the knightly riders congratulating each other on skill and bravery as the crowd clapped in polite approval. But this time, Pete had other plans.
Let's go, boys.
Pete started walking toward the center of the pitch. Ian, Clark, and Tony walked with him. From the other side of the long pitch, three quick leader riders from the opposing team walked out to meet them. Pete pulled off his helmet, letting his long red hair spill down his back. He cradled his helmet under his right arm. He held his warhammer in his left hand, the blood-splattered end balanced on his shoulder. The Stompers team captain, Sabat the Nifty, was still inside Bess's stomach, where he would stay until she pooped him out. In the first round, Bess had snatched him right off his mount and swallowed him in one gulp. It would be several more hours before he emerged in her stool, safely turtled up in his life-supporting armor. With Sabat indisposed, his second-in-command, Yopat the Crazed, would do the honors. Yopat's blue armor had looked a lot better at the start of the match than at the end, and the orange-furred sentient walked with a bit of a limp. Adult quick leaders were all about Pete's height, yet much thinner than the stocky dwarf. Leaders had two sets of arms. The first set, similar in thickness to human arms, was set low, just above the hips of their back-folded legs. Those arms, and the legs as well, ended in three pincered claws. A leader could walk on all fours, but never did. Only the lower castes touched their middle hands to the ground. The second set of Yopat's orange-furred arms technically weren't arms at all, but rather pedipalps, limbs that quick ancestral species had used to hold prey while the vertical mouth chewed away. Millions of years ago, the pedipalps had evolved into slim, dexterous appendages, ending in three thin fingers capable of fine work. The pedipalps extended from the sides of the vertical mouth, which sat just below the single softball-sized eye. Long black antennae in three rows of two down the middle of Yopat's head stuck out through the sweaty, helmet-haired fur, arced gracefully down the back of the leader's head.
Yopat, I've got a bone to pick with you. You tried to blind my mount twice.
The leader's eyes swirled with black and flecks of green. Quith eyes were normally clear, showing a multiple of vision discs behind the cornea, but that cornea showed various colors based on the sentient's emotional state. Pete knew that black meant anger, and the flecks of green meant shame and signaled an admission of guilt.
Yes, it seems strategically appropriate.
Pete's fingers flexed on the handle of his warhammer.
You'll hear from Gessford about that.
I am unconcerned about your desire to, what is the word your people use? Tattle on me.
Pete fought the urge to smash the warhammer into Yopat's head.
You're actually kind of lucky. This win means we jumped over you for fourth place. We'll be fighting for the championship at season's end while you'll go home. You'll just have to wait until next year before I get my payback.
Two matches remain in the season, human. You have the resurrected next week and they will crush you. Meanwhile, we will win both of our remaining encounters and finish one match ahead of you in the standings. we will qualify for the tournament, while you will stay home and dine on disappointment.
He held up the Warhammer.
I should make you dine on this.
Yopat tensed, eyeing the hammer.
With a weapon in your hand, you certainly like to talk, don't you, pygmy?
Pete smiled.
Oh, look at you. You know lots of our words, including ones you think are insults. Here's another one for you to remember. Ouch.
Pete whipped his helmet forward. He struck Yopat in his blue breastplate. The leader tumbled backward onto the pitch. Pete dropped his hammer to the dirt and jumped on top of the furry sentient. The other two leaders moved in to join the melee, but Clark and Ian caught them before they had a chance. The crowd roared to life once again. Pete rained down blows on Yopat's cracked torso armor. The Stomper's second-in-command screamed with pain and anger, but Pete barely heard. His armored fist splintered what was left of Yopat's blue chest plate. Long arm grabbed Pete from behind and lifted him half a meter off the ground. Pete stared down at the pair of thick, titan-covered Quith warrior arms wrapped around his chest. Leaders were Pete's size. Warriors were not. The one holding Pete had to be over 2 meters tall, and, judging by the muscles rippling beneath the enameled and engraved titan, was easily 110 kilos. Dangling in the air, Pete stared down at his foe and snarled.
Next time, Yopat, your bodyguard won't save you!
The quick warrior held Pete before him and marched to the Ridgeback's dugout with agonizing slowness, Pete's boots dangling uselessly. Pete didn't struggle. If the warrior wanted, it could break Pete's small body into pieces. The crowd was cheering, but Pete barely noticed. It was times like this that he hated being small. Twice during the match, Yopat had driven his lance tip at Bess's eyes. That was against the rules, since the eyes were the most vulnerable part of any mount, especially dinos. It wasn't just bad form, it was bad for business. Lose the big mounts fans wanted to watch, and that meant fewer butts in the stands. Flesh could be repaired quickly. Eyes couldn't. The warrior dropped Pete to the ground, then roughly turned him around. Pete looked up into the warrior's baseball-sized eye. The warrior's thick eyelids, layered with plates of protective chitin, narrowed, and the cornea swirled with dense curls of black, like runs of ink spilled into curved glass. Judging by the density of enamels and engravings on his warrior's hairless carapace, he had served in the military, spent time in prison, or probably both. The warrior pointed a pedipalp finger in Pete's face.
Next time, human, I'll kill you.
A low bass growl vibrated through both of their bodies. Pete didn't need to turn to see what it was, as the warrior's cornea reflected the image of Bess's big head leaning in close. The warrior's eye changed from black to pink, the color of fear.
Bring friends. Bring lots of friends.
The warrior's pedipalps twitched.
We shall see.
The warrior then turned and walked quickly past the approaching Ridgeback riders. Ian offered the Warhammer to Pete.
Wow, Cap. You beat the hell out of that little orange-furred bastard.
Pete nodded and took the hammer.
Next time we'll see how Yopat does without protection.
Clark put a hand on Pete's shoulder.
Come on, Cap. It's time for post-match press.
Pete frowned and looked up at Bess. The T-Rex stared at him, her mouth partially open. Pete smiled. Just the sight of her filled him with pride and love.
Did you have a fun match, girl?
The huge animal dropped its head and gently brushed her snout against his shoulder. Pete managed to stay upright, but he stumbled sideways.
Okay. Take it easy. Let's get you to the stables.
Clark and Tony went to their mounts, climbed atop of them, and headed for the outgate. Ian, the youngest of the Ridgeback's team, stared after them, his eyes glazed with the loss he tried so hard to conceal.
Ian, I'm sorry about tumult.
Did my best, boss.
Yeah. Come on, Ian. Let's head in. Bess, stable.
The two short men followed the large T-Rex out of the stadium, Pete's Warhammer twirling in his hands.
Graphic Audio presents Galactic Football League, The Rider, by Scott Sigler and Paul E. Cooley. narrated by Michael John Casey, with performances by Matthew Bassett, Jonathon Feuer, James Konicek, Scott McCormick, Amanda Forstrom, Chris Genebach, Elizabeth Jernigan, Jessica Lauren Ball, Nick DePinto, Nora Achrati, Michael John Casey, Alejandro Ruiz, Jonathon Church, Michael Glenn, Dawn Ursula, Ken Jackson, Gwen Grastorf, Brad Smith, Zeke Alton, Chris Davenport, and David Harris. Galactic Football League, The Rider.
The press conference's first question from Orlon the Questioner set the tone. A quick leader reporter would obviously gloss over Yopot's actions.
Orlon the Questioner, Quith Sports Daily. After the match, what happened out there on the pitch when you were supposed to be exchanging sportsmanlike appreciation of each other's performances?
Pete stared at the blue and black furred journalist.
Nothing more than a display of interspecies solidarity.
The reporters laughed, but Pete hadn't smiled. Pete then pointed to a normal-sized human reporter who stood for a question.
Joe Rutiliano, the Griffin Standard. Old Betts took some serious damage today. Will she be ready for her next match?
A smile finally crept across Pete's face.
Bess is tough. She's the toughest creature in the league. What you see as major damage is nothing more than scratches to her. She'll be more than ready.
A hand shot up from the back of the room. Pete nodded to the smartly dressed, heavy G woman.
Lonnie Brandish Fry Smith Parker Rodina Times. What about tumult? The death of a mount is a critical loss to any franchise. Did Ian Bajas make a mistake?
Pete felt his cheeks flush, but managed to tamp down any other sign of his simmering anger.
Ian is a great rider, one of the best in the league. Accidents happen. While fortune may favor the brave and skilled, it sometimes goes against you. The Stompers played a good match today, and tumult was unlucky. I don't think I would have played it any other way. Tumult was a great fighter. Great mount. I'll miss her. I know Ian is heartbroken over the loss.
A Sklorno female stood and chirped a question over Lonnie's follow-up.
Ellen Ailish, Chichana Net News. Do you have another Achillebator with Tumult's skills?
Pete gritted his teeth.
Come on. We can't show our hand with the championship tournament coming up. So no comment.
Lonnie shouted another question without waiting for permission.
But the Stompers were in fourth place coming into this match, one game ahead of you. Your win gives your team a lead in the points differential. Considering today's post-match altercation, if you do make the tournament, would it bring you great joy that this win knocked the Stompers out of the tournament?
Sometimes emotions get the better of us out on the pitch, sure. But we're all professionals. We would never target anyone, because without great mounts and great riders, this sport would collapse. Stompers are a solid organization. There's no bad blood on our end. But like you said, we now have the points differential with two matches remaining in the regular season. If we win both, we're in the tournament for sure. But we have the Chichana Resurrected coming up, and they're undefeated. So we need to put this match behind us and focus on the Resurrected.
Orlon the Questioner raised his pedipalp again. Pete nodded to the Quith leader.
There are rumors of financial difficulties for the Ridgebacks. Care to comment?
Pete blinked.
Excuse me?
Is Salton the Grimy interested in selling the team?
I can't speak to that. My work is on the pitch. You'd have to ask him. Thanks.
With that, Pete stood and headed for a shower to wash off the grime, the match, and the press conference. The Roughland locker room smelled of sweat, dinosaur dander, and the blood of mounts and riders alike. Pete's armor and Ridgeback's undershirt lay piled on the floor. The other riders had already showered and headed back to the stables to check on their mounts. Pete was almost always late to check on the animals and supervise the loadout. Commissioner Rachel Guestford had made it a standing rule that team captains gave interviews while still wearing their armor. Guestford traveled constantly, always using her looks and cachet as a former movie star to promote the sport anywhere she could. This week, unfortunately, she had been in attendance at Smittick's for this match, which meant that Pete wouldn't have to wait long to get his ass chewed out over the fight with Yopat. As a sport, Dinolition was still very new and barely making enough money to stay afloat. While things looked like they were picking up, Dinolition was still a marginal sport. The sentients involved had to do anything possible to get attention. Although the shower stalls had originally been used to fill water drops and bottles for the Roughland cricket team, Pete had had it converted to a real shower. Nanites cleaned the body just fine, but didn't satisfy in the way that hot water did. Throughout his career in the Galactic Circus and his stint in the backwater kill pits, nanites hadn't been available. Once upon a time, Pete had dreamed of taking a nanite shower, just like the rich, tech-spoiled people of the League of Planets. Now that he had the cash to afford them, he was already set in his ways. Hot water jetted from one of the walls, sprayed against his tired muscles. Pete turned in a slow circle, scrubbing his skin and spending extra time on the white and purple scars that covered his chest and back. He worked at his scalp, making sure he got all the filth out of his long hair. Orlon's words from the press conference stuck in Pete's head.
Sell the team. Over my dead body.
Pete bent over and touched his palms to the shower floor, trying to stretch out a knot in his back as the water cascaded over his skin. Pete's spine popped, and a jolt of pain surged through it. The damage he'd taken in the Galactic Circus, the kill pits, and in dozens of Dinolition matches was starting to show. His back hurt almost all the time. His spinal cord had been pinched more than once. Another serious hit, and he could wind up paralyzed. Medical science could do only so much to keep a battered body going. Retirement was inevitable. Pete stood and tapped the wall. The water shut off. He wrung out his long hair and then tied it in a loose tail. He tapped the wall again, and warm air from all sides blasted against his skin. He raised his arms, letting the currents dry him. After a moment, he tapped the wall again, and the dryer shut off. Pete untied his hair and stepped out of the shower cubicle. The stone floor chilled Pete's bare feet. Roughland was hardly known for its amenities. Located in the middle of the massive, seemingly endless mountain desert known as the Wastes, Roughland wasn't the kind of high-tech city for which the League of Planets was known. Settled by sentients fleeing the elitist, body-mod culture of League scientists, most Roughland buildings were constructed of indigenous materials. More often than not, that was a fancy word for rocks. Pete walked to his locker and dressed in a pair of hemp pants and a Ridgeback's tee. Bess's visage was emblazoned in black on a field of red. Pete stared into the locker at the black and orange Ionith Kraken's jersey hanging from the hooks, children's size, which fit him perfectly. With a sigh, Pete slipped into it, put on his boots with the 2-inch heels, and left the locker room. Outside the stadium, the sun had left, and so too had the crowds. Smittick's arena drew crowds for cricket games, the occasional concert, Ridgeback matches, and little else. The nearest tubeway spur entrance was 20 kilometers away, requiring people to either use their own vehicles or wheel bus from the spur to the stadium. All that isolation did provide one benefit. Ranch Ridgeback, where the dinos were housed, was within walking distance. A brown-fatigued stadium security guard nodded as Pete passed.
Good match, Pete. Sorry about Tumult.
Pete nodded and kept walking. Next to Bess, the speedster Tumult had been Pete's favorite. Pete had trained her since she left the incubator. She had been astonishingly fast, obedient, and loyal. She had protected her riders with maternal ferocity. The ranch wouldn't be the same without her. Ranch Ridgeback was just south of Smittick's Arena. Although the Ridgebacks and the Rodina Colonials, the local cricket team, shared the stadium, the Ridgebacks were a far greater draw. The Colonials had been the facility's original occupant, and the city elite believed a millennia-old sport that traced its roots back to ancient Earth held priority over the one that hadn't even hit its 10th anniversary. But when visitors came to Roughland, it was to watch the Ridgebacks. Not just visitors from Rodina, but from off-planet. Sentients spent enormous amounts of money and untold time in space just to see Dinolition matches. After a Ridgeback's contest, the city was always full of wealthy sentients, drinking, eating, purchasing knickknacks, and generally shoving giant fistfuls of much-needed cash into the city's economy. As for the Colonials, no one came from off-planet to see them, and not very many of the locals did either. Dinolition was growing, no question. At this pace, soon the Ridgeback's home matches would sell out every seat of Smittick's Arena. Ranch Ridgeback stables were made of blue wood harvested from the planet's northern hemisphere. Red veins streaked the huge blue pillars. The structure was more than tall enough to accommodate Bess's full height. Blue timbers framed heavy black bars and gates. One could never forget, ever, that most of the mounts came from ancient predators. Sometimes things went wrong, and the last thing the sport needed was several tons of carnivore running loose in the mountains. Pete stepped to the sentient access gate and into the entryway. Pete could hear the snort and lowing of beefalo from the nearby livestock area. The sound was a familiar counterpoint to the smacking of jaws and the occasional snuffle from the dinos. Pete smiled. The girls were eating and resting. Pete entered the armory. Clark was applying a composite sealant to a crack in his red armor's left thigh. He had the suit mounted on a repair rig, helmet on top, then the wide curved shoulder plates, the sleeve armor, the articulated gauntlets that covered Clark from fingertips to elbow, the cuirass, which protected his chest and the ribs, then the tasset lane, the interlinked bands that covered the waist and crotch, the family, as Clark described it. Finally, the thigh, knee, and lower leg armor, then the boots. All made of a crystal variant for low weight and high strength. All pieces capable of turtling together to create a hermetical seal that would not only protect a rider against falls from significant height, but also kept them alive inside of a mount's digestive system. Pete had been swallowed once 3 seasons back. A spider bear had gulped him right down. Once Pete got over the terror of being inside a predator, he'd actually been a little grateful to spend a day in there before the spider bear puked him back up. Grateful because he really didn't want the 10,000 plus fans in attendance that day to know that he'd literally crapped himself when the spider bear's big head had shot in for what should have been a fatal bite. Pete absently ran his hand across the orange numbers on his Kraken's jersey. The GFL players wore full body armor too, but nothing like the Dinolition rigs. Football armor was pricey, but didn't have the same life support tech. A rider's suit cost almost as much as a mount. Clark looked up as Pete approached.
Ah, there you are, Cap.
You could take the night off, Critter. You know we won, right?
Clark shrugged.
And let you be a martyr about how you're always working while the kids go out and party? Nah. Besides, I won't sleep right unless I know I got these cracks melded and test the full seal.
What, you're not tough enough to handle a couple hours of stomach acid? You big baby.
I prefer to be the digestor, not the digestee. Besides, I don't want to spend my final years eating my meals through a straw like Walker.
Critter, you gotta let that go. The game was dismount. You dismounted Walker. That was your job.
Clark nodded, leaned in closer to the crack in his armor, and squeezed more repair cement into it.
That I did.
Pete watched his friend's steady hands slowly fill the cracks. The Ridgebacks had a team armorer, Lucius Buhari, who came in the day after a match, but she rarely had anything to do. Real riders knew their gear was the difference between life and death, and did every repair they could on their own to make sure it was done right. The armorer would do diagnostics on the electrical system, the power cell, comms, and all that, but for straight-up plate integrity, Clark took care of that himself.
Looks like your suit took more damage than I thought.
This?
Clark pointed to the crack.
"'Tis but a scratch, boss. I'll fix this up, then flight check all the systems. It'll be fine.
Of course, I know. I just,
It's tumult. I get it.
Pete nodded.
Bess, too. She almost lost an eye tonight.
You better talk to Gessford about Yopat. That little orange-furred bastard deserved what he got.
Well, I figure she'll talk to me before I can talk to her.
Clark shook his head.
We aren't kids anymore, Cap. Don't you think we're getting a little old to be brawling?
Yeah, I guess. Look, I gotta check on the girls.
Clark turned back to his work.
Not then, Cap.
Pete left the armory and walked to the supply room. Inside were Tony Kester and 2 other dwarves. Dar, her skin and hair just as white as Tony's, and Rob Styx, the blue-skinned native of Satirly Six. The 3 were taking post-match inventory of the equipment boxes. Sultan was so cheap, a missing piece of tackle was cause for a blowout. Stiggs rummaged through the crates and called out item numbers. Dar touched her message board with each number called. Neither had dressed for that day's game, which meant they drew check-in duty. Every rider had a role, even the ones that didn't ride. Tony, however, had dressed, had ridden and therefore wasn't responsible for check-in. Just like Clark, Tony should have been out partying. Pete felt a swell of pride that the youngster was here, helping out with the equipment check-in instead of celebrating the win. Dar looked up and saw Pete standing in the doorway. Her face lit up with a wide smile.
Pete, did you bring your armor?
In the locker room. Can you fetch it for me?
Dar's smile vanished as her nose wrinkled.
What? You too old to pick up after yourself?
I'll go.
Stiggs headed the way Pete had come and high-fived Pete as he passed. Sticks was the team's second youngest rider and always seemed eager to please. Pete walked up next to Dar and peered into the container.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.